You know, I don't really have a, I don't think that is going to be a terribly relevant factor in the jury's consideration. This case wasn't really about the mother. This was really about the two brothers. And so we now know the prosecution has convinced just about everyone that Tamerlan Tsarnaev, the older brother, did not unduly manipulate the younger brother. But the key fact there is almost. If there's one juror who thinks that Tamerlan manipulated him, then it's over.
Let me jump in because I'm just being told he has been sentenced. Johar Tsarnaev has been sentenced to death on some counts. I just want to be precise in this language, but not all of the 17 counts related to his role in the Boston bombing. So has been sentenced to death for some counts. Jeff Toobin, what does that mean?
Well, it means the overwhelming likelihood is that he will die. This case was very closely litigated, and there will certainly be years, and I emphasize years, of appeals. And there is a chance that this death sentence will be overturned, but in federal court, most people sentenced to death ultimately are executed. In this case, there certainly will be a very strong appeal on the ground that this trial should not have taken place in Boston, that the community was too traumatized. That case was appealed even before the trial began, and it was a 2-1 verdict in the appeals court. The appeals court took that argument very seriously. I expect that will be the main point of appeal. But the important point to remember about appeals, especially in criminal cases, is they usually fail. And the overwhelming likelihood now is that young Mr. Tsarnaev will die of a lethal injection in Terre Haute, Indiana, in some time in the next few years.
So this just in here to the world watching downtown Boston, we have just learned that Johar Tsarnaev will be put to death. The jury had to be unanimous, and on multiple counts, he will be sentenced. He will be sentenced to death on counts numbers 4, 5, 9, 10, 14, and 15. Jeff Toobin, I'm being told, just a little bit of color in the courtroom, that Johar Tsarnaev has not reacted. He has not reacted whatsoever to this being read aloud. You are looking at live pictures, police presence outside, tremendous media presence, I'm sure, people there in Boston, and really the world reacting. I mean, this is the kind of story. I was there. I covered this for a month after those pressure cookers went off there on Boylston Street. It rocked this city to the core. It's an incredibly strong city, but it was horrendous. And so now the world has learned that he will be put to death. Jeff Toobin, on the point of appeals, because I was talking to Susan Candiotti earlier, she was referencing her coverage of Timothy McVeigh, and she has told me those appeals lasted 4 years. So for people who want to know when he will be put to death, to your point, it could take some time.
Easily 4 years. And frankly, Tsarnaev has better claims on appeal than Timothy McVeigh did. I covered that trial, and that trial was moved. That trial, it was of course the Oklahoma City bomb, and it was moved to Denver because of the issue of pretrial publicity in Oklahoma City. And that was one of the precedents that Tsarnaev's lawyers argued so strenuously for a change of venue in this case. So, you know, I don't think it is out of the question that this case could be overturned on appeal, but it is important to remember that most cases are not overturned on appeal, and the overwhelming likelihood at this point is that he will be put to death.
Jeff Toobin, stay with me. I think at this moment, I just want to put some pictures up on the screen, as I know we are all looking at Johar Tsarnaev's face, but let's remember those lives lost on that day in April 15th, 2013, the first three, Crystal Campbell, the youngest, Martin Richard, Lingzi Liu, and then sometime later, Sean Collier was the MIT police officer who was killed. All four victims from that tragic day in April in the city of Boston in 2013. As we have learned, that the man who committed these atrocities, a convicted terrorist, Johar Tsarnaev, will be put to death. at some point, as Jeff Toobin was mentioning, in Terre Haute, Indiana, presumably after a process of appeal. I know we have folks in the courtroom, so as soon as we can get them on the phone in front of a camera, they will let us know the color inside the courtroom, the jury, those family members. I know Martin Richards' family was inside. I know the first person to arrive inside that courthouse was the police chief there in Watertown, where that manhunt ensued in those paralyzing few days in the city of Boston, where they ultimately found Jahar Tsarnaev hiding out bloodied in that boat in that man's backyard. Again, Jahar Tsarnaev will be put to death. Jeff Toobin, as you're watching all of this sort of unfold, just at what point, because so many people, of course, want to hear what the jury went through in the 14 and a half hours of deliberations, might we hear from them immediately?
It's up to them. They are not prisoners. They are not under any legal obligation to keep secret the nature of their deliberations. Usually in a very intense experience like this, a high-profile trial, the jurors tend to discuss that issue with each other before they leave. They tend to say, how are we going to handle this? Sometimes several jurors hold a sort of joint press conference. That is often done in these high-profile cases. But it's completely up to them. They don't have any legal obligation to keep their deliberations secret. And certainly, if prior patterns repeat themselves, some jurors certainly will not want to discuss it publicly. But I expect that some will, and they can do it starting right now. Just in terms of the logistics of how this works, you know, this is a very high security courtroom. The judge almost certainly will want to go back to the jury room and thank the jurors for their service. When I say immediately, I mean in an hour or so. It's just going to take a while to empty the courtroom. But at that point, there certainly is nothing stopping any of the jurors from talking publicly about how they reached their decision.
I've been told that the judge has already polled every single one of those jurors, just making sure he or she agreed with the verdict that was being read. And I'm told that every single one of the jurors said yes. I am also being told just a little bit more color as we're all getting this moment by moment. And they made that opinion very public in the Boston Globe recently, essentially saying, as Jeff was alluding to, you know, the years and years potentially of the appeals process before Jahar Tsarnaev is put to death would be excruciating for some of these families. And they, quite honestly, didn't want to be dragged through it. They didn't want to be dragged through that emotional day from 2 Aprils ago. So that was their opinion, but clearly not the opinion of those 14 jurors, 7 men, 7 women, who unanimously decided that Jahar Tsarnaev, convicted terrorist Jahar Tsarnaev, should be put to death. Let me know, guys, if we have Mel Robbins with us, because I would love to hear Mel Robbins. I'd love to hear from you as you know, not only an attorney but the only Bostonian I have right now. Just, you know, you've been living there, talking to people. How do you think that this city will react to this?
Brooke, you know, I'm just going to talk for myself personally, because I'm in a bit of a state of shock. It's never a good idea to predict the way that a jury is going to go, but so much has been written locally, so much is talked about locally about the fact that so many people in Massachusetts are personally against the death penalty, and it didn't seem like it would be a likely result. And so when you read that verdict, I just took a deep breath, and the first thing that came to my mind were Martin Richards' family. And look, they're not the only people that were clearly impacted. There were 3 other families who had devastating losses. There were over 200 families who had family members that were injured. There were a city that was blown apart. I mean, a terrorist act right here during the Beloved Marathon. But I just immediately felt this heaviness because they had the Martin family having lost their 8-year-old, having had their daughter have both their legs blown off, having expressed such a profound opinion about the excruciating agony that they thought that appeals would be, I just felt a heaviness for them in that moment. And I truly hope, Brooke, that they're wrong about the presumption that it will be a awful, excruciating process as the appeals go forward. I hope that this doesn't mean that they're dragged back in court. I hope that they're wrong about that, because it makes me really sad to think that this verdict, while it allows our city, our country, the rest of us to move on, that for some people that were just devastatingly affected by this, it actually means it's not over.
I wholeheartedly agree with you. We all, let me just take a moment and wish peace on every single person who was touched and affected by the terrorism, by the atrocities on that day 2 Aprils ago there on Boylston Street. Mel, stay with me. I want to ask you about a note just passed along from the judge, but I also first want to just read a statement. This is a statement just made by our Attorney General, Loretta Lynch, and here's what she said in response to this. Jahar Tsarnaev coldly and callously perpetrated a terrorist act that injured hundreds of Americans and ultimately took the lives of 3 individuals. Crystal Marie Campbell, a 29-year-old native of Medford, Lingzi Liu, a 23-year-old Boston University graduate student from China, and Martin Richard, an 8-year-old boy from Dorchester who was watching the marathon with his family just a few feet from the second bomb. In the aftermath of the attacks, Tsarnaev and his brother murdered Sean Collier, a 27-year-old patrol officer on the MIT campus, extinguishing a life dedicated to family and service. She goes on, "We know all too well that no verdict can heal the souls of those who lost loved ones, nor the minds and bodies of those who suffered life-changing injuries from this cowardly attack. But the ultimate penalty is a fitting punishment for this horrific crime, and we hope that the completion of this prosecution will bring some measure of closure to the victims and their families." She ends with this, "We thank the jurors for their service, the people of Boston for their vigilance, resilience, and support, and the law enforcement community in Boston and throughout the country for their important work." That was the response just in from Attorney General Loretta Lynch. Mel, back to you. This is what we just learned from the judge, that the judge has ordered the names and the places where the jury members reside to be made public. So that this judge is saying, yes, you can now talk about all of this with your family and your friends and members of the media. So we could soon learn what it was like to sit on this jury, Mel.
Oh, I would just be fascinated, because one of the things that I'm thinking about is that, you know, particularly in a trial like this, Brooke, where there are no cameras in the courtroom, you forget about the fact that this jury has really been, while they weren't sequestered, they were truly in isolation for, you know, months and months, just focused on this particular trial. And I would not be surprised if what we find is that it was actually the closing arguments that really tipped the scales of justice in the direction of a death sentence, because the prosecution had such a masterful close and really drove home beyond a reasonable doubt the fact that Tsarnaev knew exactly what he was doing. In fact, he stood behind that Martin Richard's family for minutes, knowing full well where he was before he placed that bomb. And they ended, Brooke, after, you know, this riveting testimony, with images and videos. And so we talk about the fact that these families have had to live through so much. Well, this jury relived over and over and over again the devastation, the horror, the terror, the murders that Tsarnaev inflicted on not only the city of Boston, but over 200 victims of his terrorist act. And I think at the end of the day, it was the overwhelming just visual, visceral, detailed, awful evidence that they could not turn away from. And I really do hope some of them speak, because I would love to hear what the experience was like.
As we wait potentially to hear them speak, could even be pretty immediate. You're looking at live pictures here. This is just outside of the federal courthouse. We know in cases like this, oftentimes we will hear from attorneys. So we're going to keep one eye on the screen there. Again, if you're just joining us, this jury here in the convicted terrorist Jahar Tsarnaev Boston Marathon bombing case have decided he will receive death to Jahar Tsarnaev. But there are so many people in this amazing city of Boston who are now reacting. I'm trying to get in touch with and text one of the survivors. I've interviewed many of them over the last 2 years. I know I have Jerry Clowery on the phone with me, who survived that horrific day in April 2 years ago. Jared, obviously, just let me begin with your reaction to this verdict, sir.
How you doing, Brooke?
I'm doing okay. I think the better question is, how are you doing, sir?
I'm doing unbelievable. My day-to-day, you know, over the last couple of years has had to change, and you know, I'm happy and healthy, you know, doing things with my family and friends. My reaction, I found out today my phone's been going off the hook. I don't follow that case at all. That's what I've done to bring closure, is to not really pay attention, out of sight, out of mind. But you know, for all the victims and all the survivors of that day, whether it brings closure or not, you know, me and my family, our hearts and our best wishes go out to all of them. And as far as I go personally, you know, it's a tough job working in our law and our judicial system, and I'm just glad I didn't have to do it and have to go through that. But I stand behind with the, you know, with the jury and the judge and everybody involved. I stand behind their verdict.
So, and we're looking at a picture of you, I presume, in the days after the bombs went off, with you know, your legs wrapped up here. So you believe putting this this terrorist to death is the just punishment?
Again, not my job. I'm a citizen of the United States, so I stand behind our legal system 100%. You know, if I was in that position, I'd have to look at the evidence and look at everything myself and try to be objective. You know, I'm not the right person to ask what I believe or don't believe. I just, you know, it's not my area of expertise.
I can't imagine what the last 2 years have been like for you, but as someone who survived it, we just wanted to hear directly from you to see how you know, you were reacting to this. But let me move on and just ask about you. I know you mentioned it off the top that you've sort of put all of this to the side and you haven't been paying attention to this trial. You know, I love Boston, and it's been incredible to watch the healing process and how this has actually brought so many of you together. Can you talk to me a little bit about that, this community that has been formed in the wake of something so horrible, and how you're doing?
You're trying to get me to cry, aren't you, Brooke?
Oh, I'm not. I promise I'm not.
If I go back in my memories, you know, the friends and support, you know, new friends and support I made, you know, whether it's victims or Brigham and Women's Hospital, so many people over there, I made lifelong friends, and you know, and then just the millions of people that I've never even met before that have supported everyone that was involved in this. It's just, it's really amazing. So the transformation, some things get pulled away from you and your life goes upside down in some ways, but you try not to dwell on that and you dwell on the positive and focus on moving forward and stuff like that. I've always done that in my life prior to that day. And you know, no matter how hard it gets, it's going to get better. And, you know, just by not watching it, because I think you were mentioning when I was on hold there, you know, when you watch it, it goes over and over and over again. And realistically, the bomb was 1 second of evil, and it was a despicable act. But on the other side of it, it's followed by endless seconds of good. You know, all the people that rally together, all the people of Boston, the country, and the world. And I think as survivors and victims, you get to see more of the good than just gets aired on the news, because, you know, it's always the bomb going off and what they did.
You trying to get me to cry now, Jared Clowery, listening to you?
If that makes any sense.
It makes sense to me only as someone who has talked to so many of you and understands that the 1 second of evil, and that's why we wanted to talk to you on TV today as a survivor, to just, you know, ask about how you all have sort of seemed to have conquered that horrible moment 2 years ago. Jared, I want you to listen, because I'm now just getting a statement from a witness inside the courthouse, and I know you haven't been paying attention to this, but I do want your reaction. We're gonna read this together. I'm looking at this for the first time here. This is according to a witness in court, and I'm quoting it now. As the marshals step forward to take Jahar Tsarnaev away, he smiles wryly and makes an odd gesture. His index fingers are extended at waist level. It was like a gunslinger's two-pistol salute. Your reaction?
I mean, it's comical, really. I you painted a pretty good picture there. How about this? All the, you know, the 99% of good people, and I believe 99% of us are truly good, and I don't think any of us would trade places with him. So if that's his, you know, walk away salute or whatever, it's comical. I'm doing great things with my family and friends, and I enjoy every day of my life, as do a lot of citizens of this country. So good luck to him, you know. I don't know. Good luck if that's what you want to do.
I want to end this conversation not talking about him, but talking about you. Before I let you get off this phone, Jared, tell me a little bit more about you.
When I was younger, actually, I'll just tell you what's going on now and moving forward. When I was younger, I was a professional pool player, and then I was a carpenter because I had a son. And after the bombing, I decided, you know, I'm going to go back to pool. And I recently just got done filming. It's going to air on True TV May 22nd at 9 p.m., it's called The Hustlers, and we did a reality show about, you know, professional pool and gambling in pool. It's going to air next Friday.
Well, there you go, Jared Clowery. Best of luck to you. Thank you so much for jumping on the phone. I really appreciate it. Nice to meet you.
Thank you, Brooke. Nice meeting you.
Thank you. My best to you. And that is just one survivor of that day in Boston 2 years ago who found this gesture from Jahar Tsarnaev comical and wishes him luck as he heads toward the death penalty. Deborah Farrick is with me now. Deborah Farrick is our correspondent who's been covering this from the very beginning. Now outside that courthouse, Deborah, fill me in.
Well, Brooke, I want to tell you about the mood in that courtroom. It was silent, and even as all the different sections were read, the aggravating factors, the statutory factors, then they got to the mitigating factors, and there were some interesting revelations there. But once they got to the sentencing, and it was unanimous death on some of the counts, it was quieter than I have ever heard it before. And once the judge thanked everybody and the jury left that courtroom for the final time, Jahar Tsarnaev stood up, his lawyer Miriam Conrad sort of squeezed his arm, and we walked outside. There were a number of victims and relatives of the victims who were outside, a lot of law enforcement officials, the head of Boston's FBI Bureau here, also the U.S. Attorney. It was quiet. There was no sense of celebration. There was no sense of sort of jubilation or closure. It was an enormous sense of gravitas that this man was sentenced to death by a jury in Boston, where polls show that most people don't favor the death penalty. Martin Richards, the youngest victim, his parents were also in that courtroom, Brooke. They didn't show any visible signs. They looked very stoic. They had written a letter saying they didn't want the death penalty because they didn't want Jahar Tsarnaev to remain the focus of attention. It was so heavy in that court, even after the verdict was read, everybody knew exactly the implications now that he's been sentenced to death on some of the counts, Brooke.
Deborah, stay with me because I have more for you. But let me just throw something up on the screen as we're hearing now from different members of the surviving community. We just heard from Jared Clowery. I want to show a tweet. This is from Adrienne Haslett. She was the ballerina and is a survivor. And she tweeted, "My heart is with our entire survivor community. I am thrilled with the verdict. Hashtag Boston Strong. Hashtag Boston Safer." Just one of many voices I'm sure we'll be hearing from on CNN in the ensuing hours here in the wake of this verdict here for the fate of convicted terrorist Jahar Tsarnaev. Deborah, what about with these jurors? As these jurors were in this room, and can you just even lay of the land inside this courthouse? How close are they to Jahar Tsarnaev? And did you notice if any of them even tried to look at him when this verdict was being read, or not at all?
Well, most of the jurors were looking at the clerk who was reading out the verdict form and their findings in this case. There was one young man who sat in the front of the, it was in the front row. He was sort of looking around the courtroom, looking back at the media section, at the officials who were packing the pews there. But otherwise, it was only when Tsarnaev's lawyers asked the jurors to be polled that the jury stood, and when asked if that was their verdict, they seemed to look in Jahar Tsarnaev's direction, each of them saying yes, 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 yes. Very quiet, very somber. You know, I did notice that at least four were actually dressed in black, which is not something I had noticed previously. It just, even the victims, some of them dabbed tears from their eyes, whether it was a sense of release, whether that this was over. It's one of those things where, you know, your brain, my brain, is still really trying to process just all the different moving parts, because we did see some of the family members hugging each other outside of the courtroom. We did see some officials sort of shaking hands with one another, but nobody was speaking. Nobody was really speaking. It was almost as if the sentence itself told you everything you needed to know.
Cannot imagine the feeling inside of that courtroom. Deborah Farrick, thank you so much for the color. Let me just read you something before we go to Paul Callan. We also have a statement now from Marty Walsh. He's the mayor of Boston. He says this: "I want to thank the jurors and the judiciary for their service to our community and our country. I hope this verdict provides a small amount of closure to the survivors, the families, and all impacted by the violent and tragic events surrounding the 2013 Boston Marathon. We will forever remember and honor those who lost their lives and were affected by those senseless acts of violence on our city. Today, more than ever, we know that Boston is a city of hope, strength, and resilience that can overcome any challenge." It was Mayor Menino who was mayor during that entire ordeal there in Boston, and was pretty phenomenal throughout. Paul Callan, to you, just finally, in my remaining 2 minutes I have, you have some statistics as far as death penalty and federal cases. What can you share?
It's very interesting. You know, there was a moratorium on the death penalty from 1972 to its reinstatement in 1988 in the United States on the federal level. Since that time, since 1988, only three individuals have been sentenced to death, the last one being in the year 2003. And in cases where juries have deliberated in federal death penalty cases, approximately 34% of the time, the jury returns the death penalty. So it's highly unusual to get the death penalty, and it's only been imposed by the federal government three times since 1988.
All right, Paul Callan, thank you very much. Thanks to everyone who have jumped in as part of this breaking news coverage, as we have learned in the last hour that the convicted terrorist Jahar Tsarnaev will be put to death. This has been a case in which the jury deliberated for 14 and a half hours. This was day three, and I am sure we will be hearing in the ensuing hours. Make sure you stay here on CNN for special coverage of the reaction to death here for a man, a convicted terrorist. Before I let you go, we want to continue hearing from the survivor community there in the city of Boston. And so here is just one more tweet. This is from Sydney Corcoran. She suffered shrapnel wounds. Her mother Celeste lost both of her legs, and she just put this out there: "My mother and I think that now he will go away and we will be able to move on. Justice," in his own words, an eye for an eye. Sydney Corcoran, one of the survivors. I'm Brooke Baldwin. Thank you so much for being with me here today.